around here we've got some lovely fir trees going up, which frame the end of the building. I'm going to show you a nice little technique here now with the water-soluble graphite, where I just put some of the tone from the graphite on the paper, on my scrap of paper, and then pick up some of the tone and paint it onto the roof of the building like this, fading it off down to this end. You can just get rid of the tone as you go. And that gives you a lovely even tone across the top there. It's also very good if you've... I've used water-soluble graphite here, and I can use that now if I just moisten it. I can use it to shape the trees around the chimney, and that gives me a rather nice finish to the to that part of the picture. Another nice technique is to wet an area of the sky like this, pick up some of the tone and drop it in to make soft clouds. Can come down over the hills there, keeping the background very misty and distant, and one or two areas need to be sharpened up. And you can soften the bottom of things. And leave highlights here and there. Before I begin the painting, I just want to introduce you to one or two of the materials that I like to use. But Tim Fisher, a pastel artist from Lincolnshire, has produced this new paper now, which is archival, and it's called Fisher 400 Art Paper. The reason we like to use sandpaper is because it provides a wonderful tooth for the pastel. I also use pastel pencils and charcoal pencils in my work, for detail, etc., and for the initial drawing. And here are my pastels. I've got a variety of makes in here. This is a Unison, and this is a De La Rowney one, which is slimmer. And there are some Schmincke and Sennelier ones amongst these. It's no problem mixing different brands of pastel. When you go to buy your first set, make sure they are soft. Test them if necessary, because some brands, although they're advertised as soft, are quite hard, and it's much harder to work with. And I have a selection of different colour shapers here and a couple of brushes for cleaning up mistakes. So I've chosen the colours I'm going to use for the painting. Here's the sketch that I did outside, and I probably will change a few things, but you'll see how that happens as I go along. I'll start by applying the blue part of the sky with this cobalt blue, and you'll notice that I need to put on a fair amount of the pastel to fill the grain. I'm going to blend that little part in to show you now, and as I blend it you'll see that I can fill the grain even more. So now I'm going to put in the white fluffy clouds, and as the light's coming from right to left, these clouds will be catching the light. Down near the horizon, I really would like some warmth, so I'm putting in this pink colour, and it looks a little bit powerful at the moment, but I will start to subdue it with other colours as I go. Notice how when I'm drawing the hill, I don't draw a line like this. That's much harder to lose. I'm using the full length of the pastel to block it in. It's quicker and also doesn't leave a hard line along the top. I'm just painting in now the distant trees which define the boundary between the wild land and the cultivated land. Got a darker version of that. You'll notice at this stage how the lines of the hills and the lines of the hedgerows are all converging on the focal point. This is deliberate. So the next step is the canopy of buds and fine tracery of branches. Now in winter, this is often this beautiful red-grey colour. And quickly, we can indicate a tree in winter. Now with the charcoal pencil, I'm just putting in a little bit more of branches, finer branches. With a smallish stick, which has a corner to it, I'm pushing up the tops of the conifers like this to get a sharpish point, but also to try and make it look fairly random. Blocking it in further down. If I'm not happy with any of these shapes here, I can always just modify them slightly, make one more prominent than the others. And we have a stray one here. So we'll start with the front of the building, and I'll just block it in with this white pastel to start with. It doesn't matter about going over the edges because you can come back and tidy that up afterwards. It's not quite so easy. So this is the shadow side. Of the cottage. I'm using a terracotta pastel pencil to indicate corrugated iron on the roofs of the outbuildings. Just here and there I'm adding a touch of lighter colour to add some detail. Now for the shadow in the recess of the windows, I'm using the same purple grey pencil, and then for the actual panes of the windows, I'm using the very sharp charcoal pencil, and I'm only putting in 3.5 or 3 panes because that makes it look as though the light is shining on the glass. I'm just going to add a red door. I think a red door is always exciting and fun. So I've left a gap here for a gateway, and using the sharp charcoal pencil again, I'm drawing in the posts, and then 1, 2.5 bars. If you draw much more of a gate than that, it looks a little bit too detailed. It also gives me the opportunity to have some wild undergrowth growing up around the great gate. So now I need to work on the foreground and around the building. I want to just break up the baseline. I don't like straight lines across the bottom of buildings. It makes it look as though the building's been cut out. Now I'm going to do the field, and I'm going to start with some quite warm green. This is rather too warm, but I will modify it slightly in a moment. And with a paler colour, I'm going to skate over that, leaving patches here and there. It's also a very good way of bringing the viewer's eye into your focal point. Some of this darker purple grey is also very useful. Where this the green meets the a little bit of undergrowth around the building, I'm just going to blend that in a bit better. And take it out beyond the building just a little. just three sheep with animals. It's the same as planting flowers in your garden. Threes and fives are better than twos and fours. So that's just the light side of one. And then we'll put another just here. Doesn't look a bit like sheep at the moment, does it? And then an odd one out here. Now, on the shadow side of the sheep, I'm using this red-grey colour. And then we can add some legs. There's a little V under the tail usually, and this one needs a shadow. The shadow is very important, in fact, otherwise it looks as though the sheep are floating. And this one, maybe you can just see his head. Over here on the right hand side, I had a bit of farm machinery, and again it's a nice red colour, so it's always nice to have a bit of red in the foreground of a painting. It also echoes the door. So this is an indistinct shape as it's partly buried in the grass. So, and I just need a little bit of sharpness on this top corner. So I'll use the colour shaper to push the pastel around.